This was a tough one. I'm gonna put this water bottle down. I've been warned several times that last time I spoke, I had this in my hand, and you guys could hear me crumbling. So, to the visitors, thank you for coming, but you don't get to judge your experience at FCC today because I am not the pastor, amen. So you have to come back at least one more time.
Amen, that's good.
Steve asked me to do this. I'm like, and then I found out he wasn't even gonna be in town. So, and then Jency's gone. Those are both our pastors for those who don't know. So I'm like, I just told Jeff, you next in line. So if I get in trouble, it's up to you. It's up to Jeff to rescue me, amen. Anyway, first I'd like to thank God for just his patience. Thank Jesus Christ for his death and resurrection.
Amen.
I give an honor to my pastor, Steve Chapman, in his absence, as well as Jency. I didn't sign up to be a part of the teaching team this year. So I thought I was gonna skate around being up here. This message was not easy for me. Well, none of them are, but it was just like, man, what do you do with this message? And as I was preparing, the scripture came to me in Hebrews 4:12, where it says, "For the word of God is alive and powerful. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires."
Yes.
So I'm like, ooh.
Yeah.
So what do I add? You know, videos, jokes, stories, illustrations, or should I just focus on letting the word do the work? Which it will do that no matter what I do. The word will do what it's supposed to do. But I am supposed to get an understanding of the text and make it relatable to everybody else as far as I can, amen. But I say there has to be a balance. You know, it's kind of like our Christian walk, right? Like we play a role in this. Yes, Jesus died before us and rose again, but we still have a role to play. It's not done at that point. It is finished in the sense of he did what he was supposed to do. But we still have a race to run, amen.
Amen.
When I think about how when Pastor Steve wouldn't let me off the hook because I didn't sign up to speak, I'm like, he wouldn't allow me to just sit comfortably in my pew and cheer for him. He was saying, nah, you gotta give him the cane.
Come on.
Now, I'm not saying that it's my calling to be up here or it's your calling to be up here, but we're not to just sit in the audience and cheer. We're to get in the game, amen?
Amen.
Does that remind you of somebody? Challenging his people to step outside of their comfort zone. Who does that? Who challenges us to step outside of our comfort zone? Jesus Christ, right?
Amen.
So I haven't been able to just aimlessly wander throughout my week or weeks. Instead, I had to get into this text. My pastor didn't allow me to just aimlessly wander. Who else didn't allow us to just aimlessly wander or won't allow us?
Amen.
Jesus is calling us to be our best self. Jesus said, I did not come to abolish the law, all right? Right away in verse 17, and I'm coming from, Matthew 5, verses 17 through 48. I began to prepare PowerPoints, but I can be all over the place. And I was worried that my PowerPoints wouldn't line up with me talking. So I got through doing some of them, and I said, you know what, I'm sorry, forgive me, I'm not gonna do PowerPoints. So verse 17 says, don't misunderstand why I have come. I did not come to abolish the law of Moses or the writings of the prophets, nor I came to accomplish their purpose. Some translations say fulfill, which is complete. Jesus realizes that some of us may have gotten this wrong or misunderstood. Yes, he fulfilled the law, But completion does not mean we're done with it. Amen?
Amen.
This reminds me of some lyrics from an old rap song. And I hope I don't get in trouble. Hopefully Steve is not Facebook Live right now checking this out. So, all right, I'm gonna start the lyrics. And if you know them, help me out and just finish the line. And some of y'all, I know y'all know these lyrics, so don't leave me hanging. Tense, come on, Tense. Don't hang me out. All right, the lyrics go, all right, stop what you're doing. Amen. See? That's a So I'm gonna finish. The lyrics go, all right, stop what you're doing, because I'm about to ruin the image and the style that you used to. He goes on to say, I look funny, but y'all I'm making money, see, so the world get ready for me. See, it came to mind because Jesus is saying, stop what you're doing. It's a warning. He's about to shake some things up. Don't misunderstand why I've come. Jesus is saying, I need you to get this right. Okay, so I got a story for you. There was a young woman who was speeding. Because of the speed she was driving, it was considered reckless. Okay, she got arrested. She was taken to jail. She would have her day in court. Now, fortunately for her, her mom was an attorney. Her mom also just happened to know the judge. So she ends up getting off, or let off the hook, and it got me to thinking, there's two ways people usually handle being let off the hook. One, because they did not suffer the consequences of their actions. In this situation, they feel invincible and think, and they fall into the slippery slope of doing whatever they want to do because they got off the hook that time. All right, you know people like that or situations like that? You ever done?
Come on.
I know I have.
Come on.
Number two, because they feel so grateful to have been cleared of all the charges, they want to show their appreciation by attempting to drive safely from now on and encouraging others to do the same. Anybody feel about that? It lasted for a week, at least for me. How do you respond to being let off the hook? If your attitude is, why did I ever obey the rules in the first place, then you got it wrong. Jesus wants us to understand that the same rules apply when it comes to the commandments. My big idea for today is, you've heard of the cliche, out with the old and with the new, right? Well, that doesn't apply here. Yeah. Jesus did not come to remove the law. Actually, his arrival improved the law. A lot of us look at the arrival of Jesus as we were off the hook. But my plan today is to explain why that is not true. In verses 18 through 20, Jesus is driving home the idea that we're not to ignore even the smallest detail of God's law. One translation, or several translations, say not the iota. Don't even ignore the iota, right? An iota is something so small and insignificant that it was not insignificant, excuse me, but it's so small that you wouldn't even notice that it was missing. But he's saying, don't even ignore that. Don't ignore any part of it, okay? See, sometimes we think the Old Testament is outdated and it's done away with. Let me read something from an article is titled, Is the Old Testament Still Relevant Today? Sometimes we forget that when Jesus was around, the New Testament wasn't even written. It's what he preached from and taught. It's why the Old Testament was. It's what he quoted to the devil when he started his public ministry. Jesus read, studied, and obeyed the Old Testament.
That's good.
So that's it. I'm done. Jesus did it. So should we, amen? All right. I ain't gonna end it there. Let me read verses 19 through 20 for you. So, if you ignore the least commandment and teach others to do the same, you will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But I warned you, unless your righteousness is better than the righteousness of the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Least in the kingdom of heaven. How does that work? But I actually found out that least in the kingdom is just a nice way to say you won't be in the kingdom. If there's a nice way to say that. In Matthew 19, there's a story of a rich man. Y'all remember that story? What was his question to Jesus? How do I get to heaven? How do I inherit eternal life? Depending on which translation you read. Do y'all remember Jesus' answer? Somebody said, keep my commandments. Amen. Keep the commandments. Unless your righteousness is better than the righteousness of the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees. See, don't think about how Jesus looked at the Pharisees. Think about the peasants of that time. The people who had nothing. They looked at the Pharisees as though they were the cream of the crop. And they had it all together. So to be told, unless your righteousness is better than theirs, was like, we can't do that. It's kind of like somebody who's into basketball and they say, hey, I want to get to the NBA. How do I get to the NBA? And they tell them, well, you got to be better than Mike. And it's like, well, how do I do that? They didn't understand. It didn't make sense to them. So the Pharisees and the teachers of religious law, they could write it down. That's the word of God. They can write it down. They can hold it. Amen. They can point out what you weren't doing right. But that's just it. It was all about their hands. It had nothing to do with their heart. Amen. Yeah. See, to make it clear that we're not to ignore the commandments, Jesus takes these things a step further by providing examples of how we're to carry this out. In verses 21 through 26, he talks about how we're supposed to handle ourselves as it pertains to anger. I'm going to read 21 and 22. You have heard that our ancestors were told, you must not murder. But you commit murder. I'm sorry. If you commit murder, you are subject to judgment. But I say, if you are even angry with someone, you are subject to judgment. Angry with someone. You all get what he's saying? We're held to a higher standard. In the court system, it's murder that gets you in trouble, not anger. It's murder. But we're held to a higher standard. I know what you're thinking. You're like, even Jesus got angry, didn't he? And yes, he did. But listen to this excerpt from a New Testament commentary. Although condemning anger and insults, Jesus himself expressed grief, indignation, and called people fools under appropriate circumstances. Yet our own indignation is too easily excused as righteous, and even just anger must be expressed productively, never in a manner harmful to another person. Thus, when debating with those like the religious leaders in Jesus' day, we must speak responsibly for their correction and accept the personal consequences. When dealing with those closest to us, such as a spouse, we must humble ourselves, and what did we learn last time? Submit. What's biblical submission?
Put in the best interest of the other person.
The best interest of the other person, amen. When dealing with those closest to us, we must humble ourselves and seek the other person's best interest and love. So when we get angry, we must check ourselves. Like what Tess said last week, we must check ourselves or we can't be effective. She was talking about as far as making disciples, because that's what we're called to do. Next on the list was adultery. We live in a time where most people say, it's okay to look, it's okay to check out that woman. It's okay to check out that man. And not only do they stare, they get upset with you or think something wrong with you, and you're like, hey, I got blinders on. I'm not trying to see what's to the left or the right, amen. They can't understand that. But Jesus challenges that way of thinking. He says, you've heard that the commandment says you must not commit adultery, but I say anyone who even looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. There goes their heart again. It's always about the heart. Heart, not the hands.
Amen. Jesus wants to deal with your heart before your hands get you in trouble.
Come on.
When actually your heart gets you in trouble, your hands will just be held as the cops.
That's good.
I'm going to read verses 29-30. So if your eye, even your good eye, causes you to lust, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your hand, even your stronger hand, causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell.
Amen.
Amen. Anybody ever had to do anything or do something without being able to use your strong hand? You're right-handed and it was in a cast, so you were forced to use your left. Anybody? Or the other way around, you're left-handed, something's wrong with your hand, you're forced to use your right. Well, if you never had to do that, that's very difficult. Unless you're, I'm going to mess this word up, what they say. And we, yeah, somebody else say it for me. That's it, that's it. Nancy, she just raised both her hands. She's ambidextrous. Amen. Amen. All right. As bad as it is to have to use your lesser hand, it's nothing in comparison to your entire body being thrown into hell. So deal with the attitude of adultery and you won't have to deal with the act of it. Jesus goes on to teach about divorce. Verses 31-32 says, you have heard the law says a man can divorce his wife by merely giving her a written notice of divorce. But I say that a man who divorces his wife, unless she has been unfaithful, causes her to commit adultery, and anyone who marries a divorced woman also commits adultery. So when it mentions the Old Testament, it's talking about when Moses basically gave them permission to get divorced for just about anything. But see, Moses permitted divorce as a concession to their hard hearts. That was not God. That was not what God originally intended. Even though you're permitted to leave after one has cheated, you don't necessarily have to. If hard hearts caused Moses to permit divorce for anything, but Jesus says no more, we should probably do a heart check before we end ours. Now, that being said, all marriages are just not going to work out. So I'm not here to say or condemn anybody, okay? It takes two to tango. You do all that you can to make it work, amen?
Amen.
But make sure you do a heart check. Okay, I'm going the wrong way now. Now we're going to deal with vow making. This was always like yesterday, you know, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Some translations said do not swear. When we say we're going to do something, we really don't know that we'll be able to do it. We only know what our intentions are. Lord willing, I found to be is a good answer. I got an uncle. You can't ask him anything without him saying Lord willing. Now, his intentions are good. I don't think he's using this excuse, but I mean, it's actually the truth when you think about it. Hey, I'll see you next week. Or hey, will I see you next week? Lord willing. I'm gonna try to see you. I hope to see you. My plans are to see you. Lord willing. Hey, you gonna watch the game tonight? Lord willing, because Comcast be going out. You know what I'm saying? Lord willing should be your answer. With that being said, do not use Lord willing as an excuse when you didn't make an attempt to keep your word.
Come on.
Instead of an apology, you're talking about, I guess God had other plans. So, I also have, I tried to do some parallel scriptures when dealing with, okay, you know what, I'm gonna move right along because I got all my papers over. to touch on revenge, because that was the next thing discussed. Now, this is an area from the Old Testament where a lot of us probably got it right, but that's unfortunate. All right, give me a second. See, Exodus 21 through 23 said, but if there is further injury, the punishment must match the injury. A life for a life, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, hand for a hand, a foot for a foot, burn for a burn, a wound for a wound, a bruise for a bruise. But here in Matthew 5, Jesus says, you gotta squash it. You gotta let it go. You have to forgive them. He says, if they take you to court for your shirt, give them your coat as well as the shirt. Then we move on to loving your enemies. And see, not taking revenge and loving your enemies go hand in hand. And I know that because in Romans 12, verses 19 through 20, it reads, dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord. Now, it's still not your job to be like, I hope they get what they got coming. All right? That's not our place. Verse 20, instead, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on their head. Amen? So when it comes to loving your enemies, just do the opposite of what feels right. It's not natural. It's not natural. Saying, bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. That's something you have to learn. That's something you have to work on. It doesn't come naturally. But seriously, love your enemy, not just your neighbor. Let me tell you this. As I'm getting ready to close, if you're not reading your word, then you will not be able to follow through on a lot of this.
Amen.
This will be hard enough if you are diligently, so you can play that too. This will be hard enough if you are diligently seeking the Lord. So without Bible study, daily devotions, prayer, and godly relationships, you can forget about it.
Amen.
It's not natural. To be good in all these areas is not natural. We all have different areas that tempt us, and we need to recognize what those areas are, because knowing our weakness can actually be our greatest strength. If it means staying away from certain things. Oh, I don't need to go there because that takes me back. I know I came out and started off with a song that took me back, but, you know, please forgive me.
You ain't stay there.
Now, usually I pass this point of the service on to one of our pastors. Come to the altar. No problem. Here at FCC, we have this thing that we do where we say, we believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and I've taken him to be my Lord and Savior. Now, if there's anyone who doesn't have a relationship with Jesus, and you're ready to do that right now, if you're ready to make that step, then this is the time.
Yeah.
We have a few elders here today. We have some prayer warriors here today. You can also pull them to the side if you don't want to come up here to the front right now. But I want you to, you're welcome to sing along the words of the song.
Are you hurting?
I'm sorry, I thought the words were different. Okay. All right, so thank you, and enjoy the rest of your Sunday.
Amen. Amen.